tongue long. Golden child, king under God, Socrates, philosophies. Pick your pose. My sex appeal. Shout out Fan Meal, Fan Meal. I want to speak one-on-one with your favorite artists, favorite athletes. We did it Saturday, you hear me? For the good reverend. What's up, y'all? Hope y'all had a great weekend. I was good. As long as I'm healthy, as long as everybody in my family's healthy, that's what it's all about. Yeah, shout out to the Jones girls over there from Detroit. Nights Over Egypt, you know, I'm gonna keep it real with you. That's off my wife's playlist. Whenever we go away on vacation, we just hear vibes, and that song has always stuck to me. And for some reason, when we started Corona Vision, I just and now it's like it's the theme song. Shout out Titi Barber, what's up? So you know, we in the building, El Condor, Ciroc night tonight. We got a big night. None other than the Reverend Al Sharpton. A person who's been fighting for the people probably since I was born or before I was born. The last of the Mohicans. The last of the Martin Luther King thing, the Martin Luther King days. You know, so we're going to talk to him about just around my whole, you know what the vibes is. Let me see if the Rev came in yet. I know his daughter's doing the theory. Just like me, so you know. Shout out to Rachel Noyd, everybody at the National Action Network. You know what I'm saying? People been fighting for the people for a long time. You know? You know what I'm saying? If y'all see him, just let me know he's here. You know what I'm saying? So y'all got to help me out. All the regulars. So the Fat Joe Show become a thing. Heavy. Fleazy. Heavy. Negotiations with P. Diddy. Sean Diddy Combs. Heavy. Yes, we are the realest in the game. Heavy negotiations with P. Diddy Combs. You see, he already got me for the Ciroc, but little revolt action. Just moves, man. Just moves being made, you know? Really, really blessed. Let me see. You know? The God don't really, you know, what's up, Jen? Shout out to everybody. Up NYC crew, Pito Cracks, what's up? Up NYC crew, 158th Broadway, 207th Indictment, we clicking. You want the vibes, you go there. We clicking. That's Hector. Hector Lavoe, baby. Ya tu sabes, papi. Yesterday was, would have been the Puerto Rican Day Parade. And if you're not really from New, if you're not from New York City, you don't understand. New York City, Puerto Rican Parade, everybody's Puerto Rican. Black people, Asian, white, whoever you name, we down the middle of the street. We having some of the illest parades. 5 million people in the middle of the street partying, eating food, having a great time. So we missed that yesterday for the corona. But shout out all my Boricuas, all my New York Ricans, because I never really rated that. Mama Silva's, you know, it's crazy because we got a thing where Puerto Ricans from Puerto Rico that were born and raised in Puerto Rico, for some weird reason, they think that the Puerto Ricans from New York ain't really Puerto Rican. And that's some shit between us. I don't even understand. I just saw like a little trailer of a documentary that they made about that too, where I was just like, yo, this is amazing to me because, you know, our ancestors are from Puerto Rico, and when something happens to Puerto Rico, we go hard, you know? So, you know, when we're like almost a second class Puerto Rican, that's a whole nother show. Like that's a whole other thing. I'm looking for him. Another way they could do it, Rachel, is he just could pull up off his the real Sharpton and just say, yo, I'm here. And I'll just click on like that, like just a comment. That's the way to do it too. The Rev is on the check-in. You know, we never false advertise. Never ever have we false advertise. So it's weird. We'll talk about that another time, but you know, Puerto Rican Parade, we go out there 5 million deep and represent La Boricua. Yeah, you know what it is. And then, you know, sometimes, you know, we ain't the real ones. It's a weird thing, bro. Let's see. I am self-made, so I'm able to talk about anything I feel like. I have no boss. So amazing when you don't have no boss. That's another thing. Everybody on here, man, we got to work. We got to pay the bills. But you got to try to be an entrepreneur and own your own business, bro. That's the only way you're going to be your own boss. It's the only way you're going to liberate yourself. True financial freedom is being your own boss. Nobody out here telling you what to do. Nobody out here, you know what I'm saying? So, Rachel, I'm on the check-in. You know, some people love Fat Joe. Some people can't take the real. Some people want to be hypocrites. Some, you know what I'm saying? Some people just like the lie. Like, you ever seen people, even within our own races, I'm talking about us, not just Puerto Rican, just us. You know what I mean? We like to, some hypocritical shit sometimes, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I speak the truth. I speak what I believe to be the truth. Now, I'm not the smartest man in America. I don't speak for everybody, but, I talk what I believe to be true. You know? Where the good Reverend Al Sharpton. You know, the people want to see him, you know what I'm saying? Reverend Now, shout out to Ruben Diaz on the check-in, the Bronx Borough President. Everybody on the check-in, the Fat Joe Show, and all the rappers, and all the biggest stars on earth that's here on fake accounts. We love you too. We know you tuned in. We know you tuned in. Everybody here on the fake accounts, we know you tuned in. The biggest and the best. Will Smith probably under here under Jack Rabbit Red or some shit. It's all right. You want a pinch of the real? This is where it's at. This is the big, big show. Y'all, P's a Rock. What's up, my brother? P's a Rock, man. He's police, NYPD. I know him for years. A beautiful person. Soon as the episode happened with George Floyd, I seen him posted on his Instagram quick. He said, nah, this is murder. And I respect him for that because it wasn't until now that I ever seen police officers come up and say, you know what, that was wrong. You know, and we need a lot more of that. Heavy BX, I'm looking for the Rav. Man. You know, we got to let the Rav get it together because, you know, if I don't know social media, Reverend Al Sharpton definitely don't know social media. Yo, if I be up here bugging out and shit, it wasn't to Corona I had to learn this fucking, this IG live shit. Yeah, drop dead beast. Yo, drop, I gotta call you. I'm sorry, you called me the other morning. I was sleeping, bro. You know? 50 pull-ups every morning, you'll learn social media. Get out of here, man. You guys are crazy, man. If I listen to y'all, me on the barber, boom, 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 boom. As a, be on the lookout for Reverend Al. Even though I'm seeing everybody else, I know the Rev, he on time too, so he definitely, his Wi-Fi is definitely, let me find out he got the Teddy Riley connection. What's up, mommy? How you doing? My mother's on the check-in. She loves the good Reverend Al Sharpton. You know, we New Yorkers. You know, I moved down to Miami whiles back. You know what I'm saying? Just to stay out of trouble, just come over here. And I love it down here. But, you know, we New Yorkers all the way through and through. So. We visitors. You know what I'm saying? Home team, the Miami home team will tell you, yo, they visitors, man. All right, we accept that. Thank you for having us, man. It's probably one of the only places on earth I've been able to find peace. You know what I'm saying? So after, you know, you land in Miami, right? And I'm not trying to offend nobody. I know New York started checking like crazy. But when that plane landed and I look out the window, I see the blue water. I just smile and just walk like happy through the airport. And then when I'm coming up in New York, it's just dark. It's just a hustle and bustle. And I got to do this when I come to New York. Like, you know what I'm saying? So it's a difference. I'm looking for Reverend Al. He'll be here. I don't know what's going on. Know what's going on. I'm looking for the Rev. I'm looking for the Rev. That's not like him to be late. Yo, Jay, stop it, Joe. You 305. Now, I never denied. I live in Miami 17 years. Like, I love Miami, bro. Like, I don't deny it. I love it. I ain't up here saying I don't love it. I'm just saying we was born in New York City, bro. And, you know, that's where I'm from, man. You know how you know every block? Yo, it's the big show. Yo, right here. Yo, Breon, what's good? You know what I'm saying? It's, you know, I love Miami, but, you know, New York is where I'm from. The point is, wherever you from, right, so you made a couple of dollars to get out of wherever you was born or whatever. You know where you from when you have to admit, have to think about if you pass away, where would that casket drive to? That's your answer. That's your answer. You know what I'm saying? So As much as I love Miami, I know mad New Yorkers move to Atlanta. When they pass away, God forbid, that casket come back to Harlem, it come back to Brooklyn, the Bronx. And you know, that's all I'm saying, Dre. You can move to Beverly Hills. You pass away, that casket coming to North Miami. And that's what I'm talking about. You know? Shout out to the youth. Reverend Al Sharpton started out Martin Luther King, the youth division. I believe it was the breadbasket. And then it's beautiful to see that his legacy has lasted so long and he's still putting others on. So like a name I keep hearing everywhere because she putting in that work is Tamika Mallory, right? And I get it, Rachel. I'm here from Reverend Al. We ain't got no boss. They saying the Wi-Fi is acting up, but he's coming. You know what I'm saying? My Wi-Fi was acting up. I was like, yo, we didn't have no power for like a whole hour. And it was storming over here. And I was like, oh, shit, I can't interview Reverend Al from the car. You know what I'm saying? Y'all, Breonna, get no bigger than the show. And get no... I'm not taking no talk back, man. You know, we got journalists. Then there's journalists. Then there's Dan Ravers. You know, I'm not taking no talk back. You know, I rap my whole life. Now I'm into journalism. And you want to call it hip-hop journalism? They call it hip-hop journalism. But you don't know who I know. And that's the problem. Because when you trying to competition, trying to figure me out, I'm tap dancing over here. They turn around, damn, he had Adrian Colonna on Friday. Damn, Reverend Al? Jesus, like, what is the... Guy keep coming with the... You know what I'm saying? He just... Tomorrow, somebody else. Wednesday, somebody else. Thursday, some... Throwback Thursday is my favorite day of all the time. You know, we done had the people you can't get. We done had the God Rock Kim. We done had Chuck D, a public, you just can't get them, guys. Look for their interviews. They don't exist. You can't get these guys. This is 25, 30 years of relationships. Free for you. Free. Free. Love. Reverend Al Sharpton, he's having Wi-Fi problems, but he's going to be here. We're not worried about that. So we had everybody on here since Diddy. To Mike Tyson, to Kenya Barris, and man, we got everybody on. We even had Breon on here after he did the Teddy Riley. Breon, the guy behind the Teddy Riley, like Jam. Oh, Jam. Y'all Breon, but he's a serious music exec. Down with Jamie Foxx, down with Clive Davis. See, y'all was clowning him, but y'all ain't know he was a real one. You know what I'm saying? And those who know, know. You know? It's crazy out here, man. But yeah. So, you know, Reverend Al, he leaving the legacy, but he opening the doors for other activists, young activists to come along. And you see Mice on the General doing this thing up in the Bronx. And all over. I've seen him in Washington, D.C. I've seen him in Minnesota, and that's the way to turn a negative to a positive. The man did jail time, now he's talking for the people. And there's a certain thing, when you look at the immunity the police have to where they can catch you on a corner one day and just kill you for no reason and get away with it, to actually go in the street or go in the precincts or go in the courthouse and activate against them and speak up against them, knowing that on the wrong night they can kill you. You know, we had, you know, as lit as it is right now, this ain't like the 60s. The 60s, imagine you going to the protest right now, Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. And every leader that was leading the protest gets murdered in the process. So in the 60s, Martin Luther King was giving stuff like I Have a Dream. They murdered him. Then Malcolm, they murdered him. JFK, Bobby Kennedy, they murdered him. And they were still out there protesting for rights. This is real shit. This is real shit, guys. You take it like it's simple. Nah, it ain't simple. Ain't nothing simple about it. Ain't nothing simple about risking your life for the love of your brothers and sisters. Nah, bro. Ain't nothing like it. Breon. I hear you. I'm waiting for the Rev. This is definitely not like Rev now. They telling me his Wi-Fi is messing up. So I guess they got to get creative or whatever the case may be. But I'm still much of a shit talker where I can entertain you for the time being. And I know you could be watching chicks twerking right now and getting down. But you choose to hear the shit talker. Know what I'm saying? And shout out to my brother Michael Blackson. They say he the new UF. But be careful. You know, Cosby was down when UF set. Sheesh. Sheesh. You heard that? They call it my brother, Michael Blackson, the new UF. Careful. You know, Cosby was in UF set. Careful. Man, oh man. I don't want to take nobody else. I don't want to hit nobody else for the time being out of respect for the Rev. I don't want to be talking to somebody else and then the Rev come on and then, you know, we disrespected the culture. You know what I'm saying? Rayshard Brooks out in Atlanta. Man, he looked like a great guy, huh? And don't know if he's right or if he's wrong, but the conversation is being had. So you're seeing everything right now. So years ago, these things was happening, but we didn't know like that because it wasn't on video. Well, we knew the brown and black community, but our white brothers and sisters didn't know that this was going on. So I seen a video recently of a white guy beating up the cop, taking his taser gun, jumping in the cop car, driving off, crashing into shit. Nobody killed him. God bless him. They didn't even think about shooting him. This young man told him, yo, just close the door. You know, I had too much to drink. I'm sleeping. Then what are you supposed to do? So you drunk? You instead of driving and killing somebody, you're in the parking lot sleeping for a little hour or two so you can drive home. You could drive two blocks away. I just think they could have dealt with him a different way where it didn't have to go there. Now, he was hooking off. He snuffed both of them. He took their taser, turned around, shot at him. I don't know the law. I can't tell you. But they got to, you know, the police there for sure have a better chance of winning that case than George Floyd, who we just seen get lynched. Anita's neck. I still can't see it, though. Every time I see George Floyd, for 20 minutes and I'm just trying to really make sense of it. That shit fucks me up. And so you see the outpour of the people and you see why the people are raising hell and they on the street because it just don't make sense. Like, it just don't make sense. Like, when they put their knee on his neck and he's telling them, yo, I can't breathe. You know? And so my thing is, so where they looking at, you know, both ways, saying, chances are if that was a white boy, they would have took his keys and told him, yo, come to the precinct and get it tomorrow. Here's a cab, go home. But then all that escalated. And there's a thing, you know, I spoke to Spike Lee about this. And Spike told me, that 400 years of slavery, this is Spike Lee, right? Told me, Joe, 400 years of slavery, you think that isn't embedded in our DNA and our psyche, and that's why we stressed and we got high blood pressure and we got all this. So Spike was trying to make sense of that, right, to me. And I was like, I'm not saying I didn't buy it. I'm just saying, damn. So you know how they say they put steroids in the meat, and when you eat it, you eat the steroids. So he's saying we just got it in us for 400 years of slavery and oppression. And so if you ever notice that when the cops stop somebody, they always nervous, like brown and black people, but they're complying and they talking to them but as soon as they go to put on them cuffs, you see the person, just something happens, right? When they go to put the shackles on, the cuffs, you could be the most calm person, and it turns into like, like, you ever noticed that? And so when I see these cases where they're about to put the cuffs on them, and that's when everything goes into like, and I always think back to Spike when he was telling me 400 years is in your memory, is in your DNA. You know what I'm saying? So, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know. I know Rachel's trying to call me, man. I hope Reverend Al can get that Wi-Fi. You know what I'm saying? Because what about the lynching? What lynching? What you talking about? What you talking about? So I've been stopped. You know, I've been stopped. I was telling Ruben Diaz this earlier. I was stopped. I was already Fat Joe, maybe 8 years ago, 10 years ago. I was driving my mother. And when I got out, they stopped me for no reason. It was like 125th Harlem. And I pulled over, showed them license registration. They said, get out the car. By the time I went out the car, they had checked my whole waist from the front to the back. This guy was so nice. He was swiping like a credit card. He was swiping, you know? And so he's checked my whole waist. You know, I ain't got no gun. But I'm like, yo, my man, I need to know. Like, you know, I need to know. Maybe you could tell Rachel. Maybe you tell Reverend Al to go in the car. I don't know. It don't, you know, we just on IG shooting it, you know, and in front of my mother and all that. And I was upset at the cop. You know what I'm saying? But I didn't swing on the cop. And because I know they will shoot you. So apparently, this ain't just been happening to black and brown people. So you wouldn't have that many white people marching in the middle of the street protesting too. So obviously they're doing it to white people too. And so that's what you see out in the middle of the streets. So you got voices, you know, people are voiceless. I remember a cop smacked my cheek off in front of Forest Projects knowing we ain't got no lawyers, knowing we ain't telling nobody, knowing we ain't this, and just getting away with the shit for kicks and giggles. And there's nobody we could tell or fight or whatever. You know what I'm saying? So they would just get away with it. They would just get away with it. So, that's what you're seeing out there, the voices. And real change has happened. You know, the governor of New York has made some change. And Carl Hastings, we got Carl Hastings tomorrow. He's from the Bronx. He's the speaker. And he passed that law in fast time. Oh, man. So Reverend Al just hit me, say he been trying to get on for 30 minutes. Ain't no internet connect. We still waiting for you, Reverend Al. If you can, please try. You know, I'll take some callers from now until you figure it out. Call something. Damn, man. I definitely want to hear what Reverend Al got to say, boy. You know, he's been really busy at George Floyd funeral, Minnesota, back to Houston. He's been all over, you know what I'm saying? So. Take a couple. Vibe with the people till we find them. Yeah, Sav, we need Reverend Al. You know, that's it. It's a big deal for the Fat Joe show. You know, the big show. So I'm trying, don't give up, Reverend Al. You never give up. Don't give up. Find that Wi-Fi. See, this is this guy. You know, Reverend Al, you know.
Yo.
Okay, so you added. Let me see your face, my brother. I've seen you about 100 times. Say, add you. Man. What you got to say? What's your name?
Yes,
what's
sir.
What's going on?
My name. I'm a rapper. You heard?
So you want to talk about, man, we was on some serious shit right now, man. So what's your name? Where you from?
Man, my rap name is Big Guabo Two Times. I'm from Roanoke, Virginia. But I needed a chance to show you what's up with me. You feel me?
I can't see you, my brother. I really have to see you. If I don't see you, I got to cut you off. So what you saying, you? So we can check out the raps?
Like, if I could show you, like, a real quick, like, you know what I'm saying? Of my music, and you could tell me how it is for me.
Why don't you tell us your Instagram so we can go and check it out?
All right, say that. All right, my Instagram is all lowercase, BIGGUA. A P P O O O O O, man. It's too long, but you know what I'm saying?
All right, we're going to check you out, bro. We're going to check you out, all right? All
right, man.
Stay up, my brother. All
right, bro.
You know, we out here trying to talk that real, you know. That real of real right now. You know, we got Reverend Al, you know?
What up, Joe?
What's up, my brother? How you doing?
I'm chilling. I'm a big fan. I watch your show, like, been watching it for the last 3 weeks. You know what I mean? Big fan.
Yo, it's hard work, man. It's hard work pulling this
I'm already
off,
knowing.
Y'all.
I'm already knowing.
What's but anyway, your name? Where you from?
My name is Jay. I'm from the Bay Area, Oakland, California. We respect you out here.
I love the Bay Area. Shout out to Big Vaughn. Shout out to Chewy Gomez.
Exactly.
You know,
yeah.
All the guys out
you,
there.
You know what's legends. Going on.
The legends, man. So what you been up to, man?
Nothing. Job got me working from home, you know, and just that's it. Working from home, trying to stay healthy with my workout.
Are you still believing that the coronavirus is out there, or are you thinking it don't exist?
I definitely believe it's real and it still exists. And right now it's spreading, you know, due to all the protests, is the case is spiking back up.
So you got to take care of yourself, man, and put the mask on, the gloves, you know.
Most definitely.
Everybody laughing at me. You know, I live on the water in Miami, and I was seeing every boat come by with like 50 people, no mask, everybody partying. Shout out my brother Eve Rivera. God bless you. Happy birthday, Chop. My man Eve had a birthday party like 2 days ago. He hit me up. He had 100 dudes there with no mask on. I'm like, yo,
oh, man.
I can't come over there, bro.
Sheesh.
You know what I'm saying? I can't.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't do it. My brother, you stay safe out there in the Yay area.
Exactly. Right? Same to you. Yep, yep.
Stay up, man. God bless. Right. Shout out to Gazi Empire Records out there. You know, in the Bay Area. You know what it is, man. You know. Anybody not believing the anybody not believing the corona right now. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, Erica.
What up, homie?
Y'all, I've been waiting on Reverend now, but his Wi-Fi is bugging out.
Oh, word. I thought I missed him. I tuned in.
He texts me right now from his phone number. I can't call him while I'm on the show. Like, I guess we're going to have to reschedule or something because I'm waiting for it. You know, I wanted Rev Al to talk that talk. You know what I'm saying?
No justice, no peace.
Erica, New York, to everybody, Erica's a friend of mine. She's been in the street since Tupac. I met her with Tupac.
Whose birthday is tomorrow? Whose birthday is tomorrow?
Oh, man. I had Napoleon on the show. And then just last week, it was really incredible. Napoleon from the Outlaws. So, Erica, you deal with stopping the violence. So, when they say defund the police, they mean people like you. Right? So, tell us the name of your thing. I'm going to elaborate to where we're going, but tell us about yourself, Erica.
So, my name is Erica Ford. I'm from an organization called Life Camp in New York City, but I'm a bigger part of the New York City Crisis Management System. It's 22 sites across the city and over 60 organizations and city agencies that come together to co-produce public safety. And so, most of the times, we're there before the 911 call is made. We are interrupting and mediating conflicts and incidents of violence for those who have the highest potential to shoot somebody or be shot. And so we not only deal with interrupting the violence, we deal with helping the people heal from losing your loved one from violence. So we on both sides of the guns. We're in the schools, we're in the prisons, we on the block, we all over where violence has the potential to brew its head.
So hold up 1 second, Erica. So what they saying, when people say defund the police, they mean, like, if you have a fire in the house, they call a fireman. If you have a health thing, you dial 911, they send right. you an ambulance. But right. anything to do with domestic violence or somebody in the family ain't take their medicine and they bugging out or anything like that, they call 911 and they send a police officer with the guns. And right. they come in there aggressive and they not really understanding the situation.
Right.
So
right.
when they say defund the police, they mean like not get rid of all the police, but when you have a person who has mental issues, you right. send a psychiatrist there instead
right.
to talk him off the cliff, get him his medicine, right? And so that's what they mean by...
Yo, I was at one of those calls a number of different times, and I know for a fact, if I was not there, that person would have been beat down. Because for people who are mentally imbalanced, they not here. You know what I'm saying? And so you have to be able to defuse the situation. You can't treat everything with a hammer. And the police come in and they do everything with a hammer. And you know, you can't fix a freaking window with a hammer. You know, you're going to break the glass.
So, Erica, I've been real passionate about your program. So I know you over 25 years, so the credibility is, you know, you batting 10 million. And so you said, Joe, every year in New York City, there's something called Summer Youth. I was in Summer Youth. Yeah. So this is how kids get a little job for the summer, cleaning the playgrounds, whatever the case may be. That way you get your money up so you can buy your little outfits yep. to go to high school, whatever, and be fly. And this year, due to Corona, they stopped the Summer Youth program. And so you've come up with, you did like a big IG telethon 24 hours last week.
Yes, yes.
Where
yes.
people came on in, people donated so that you can hire the youth and give them different jobs, because the summer is when all our kids really die, because everybody's outside.
Yes.
You know, you easily influenced by your other friends that want to do the dirt. And so I think it's the most incredible program in the world to get kids off the street and get them out of trouble and get them working for the summer. So, you know, we donate it. Plus, we take some of your kids in our stores to work.
Yes.
You know, I'm a mentor in a workshop. Tell us about that, Erica, because that's real important.
So, you know, even after coronavirus, a lot of families lost the matriarchs and patriarchs of their family. And so, therefore, that money that they used to get from their nanny or whatever, that stuff was going. And they canceled some of you. They didn't even cut it. They canceled it. And so we raised $150,000 the other day. And so we're still in the contract of raising money so that we can hire as many young people as we can. And we also spoke to some folks in Minneapolis. We're going to give some young people jobs in Minneapolis so they can work with the violence prevention folks to help build back the city. And also in Kentucky with some of our partners, and give as many people. We're doing master classes. We're doing helping people build, you know, rebuild their offices to be social distancing approved, and just doing different things that they that's Rachel calling me now.
I know she mad because, you know, Rachel, my girl, man, and she really want Reverend Isle on here. Y'all don't know Rachel is Reverend Isle's right hand woman, and so she's trying to make it happen, and you know, we try to fill in the gap. I know Reverend Isle will come either later or tomorrow or the next day. Reverend Isle got my back, so he know me. I'm not worried about the Rev, you know what I'm saying? I know he's gonna come through.
No doubt.
So tell them the information, and everybody out there, donate $5, $10, $50. Let's get these kids off the street. I'm going to post something on my Instagram because I got a bunch of people who's asking me. So in a good way, I guess, people are now saying, yo, I want to Black Lives Matter. I want to invest back in the community. How can I invest? You know, and I'm telling them what I'm doing. I said, yo, I'm co-signing Erica Ford's thing because I know, you know what I mean? I come from being the poorest. My mom's on here. She don't like when I talk like that. But I come from the bottom, from the projects, free cheese. And I know the impact of a summer job had on me. So when we talk about our youth, the youth is the future. When we talk about how we get them out of, you know, there's a lot of gang violence going on in New York. How we get
a lot of gang violence.
So how do we get our kids to think positive? And I think what you have is the perfect outlet. So tell them, how could they donate to your
LifeCampInc.com, LifeCampInc.com. They can go to LifeCampInc on Cash App. They can go to LifeCampInc. On PayPal, LifeCamp Inc. on Instagram. The link is in our bio, LifeCamp Inc., and they can donate through there. And the thing about the jobs is also when young people are idle in the community, that's when police roll up and move out of here. You got the social distancing laws and so on and so forth. And so, therefore, it is very important to get these young people jobs this summer. It's very important. It's very, very, very...
I tell my following all the time, I ain't for sale. I ain't got no boss. I tell it like it is. Trust me, if I'm co-signing your thing, it's because it's right on the money.
No.
Otherwise, I wouldn't co-sign. I'm not.
I know that's a fact.
We need to get these kids some jobs, some money in their pocket, make them feel responsible, make them realize they can do more in life.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And that's the most important
There it is right there.
Right now.
She put it right. Sensory put it right there at Life Camp Inc. Right there. Somebody put it in your comments.
I'm going to post it up. I'm going to post it up. I'll holler at you, Erica. Thank you.
All right. I'm going to call Rachel and help her out.
All right. Peace. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. You know me. Let me tell you something. I ain't going to lie. You can call me old head, whatever you want. When I first started on this IG thing, I was having mad trouble. And I had to learn that even when I start getting shaky, you know, I got to call my daughter. You know what I'm saying? So I get it. The Reverend Al never diss. Never diss. He with us. 1,000,000%. We see this person. We just going to vibe out for a couple more. You know what I'm saying? And you know, the big, big show. It's going to remain the biggest show in the game. Because you don't know who I know. But I'm telling you, bro. The best bet. I'm going to post up Erica's thing. And what I'm telling you is, they got rid of some of you. Now the kids ain't got nothing to do. They're going to be hanging out. You know, we always got that peer pressure. The best way is to get them a job. You know what I'm saying? So I heard everybody's thing, you know, NAACP, this one, that one, this one, this and this. I'm like, yo, I know who's really on the streets. I know what these kids really need. And that's where we at with it. You know what I'm saying? He said he did some of you 26 years ago. Jesus. I did mine's longer than that. You see, they go, they ask to get on, and then when I get them on, they don't want to talk. See, a lot of frauds, man. You know what I'm saying? You gotta know how to, no matter what, step up.
What's the deal, Joe?
Your joint is freezing. What's your name?
You said what, my brother? Well, my name is Hakeem, man. I'm from Dallas, Texas.
All right, man. You out there in Dallas?
No, I'm out here in California right now. I'm in Los Angeles.
All right. I'm in Dallas. So what's going on, man? Talk to me, man. You in the house with the Rona? You in the streets? You think it's over? What's going on?
Shit, I'm in the house right now, you know what I'm saying? But I'm trying to get this music shit popping, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. What kind of advice you got? You know, man, I just got out of prison, you know what I'm saying? I'm trying to...
Man, don't give up on you. I'm going to tell you the first advice. Get a job. That part is the first. Get a job, right? Maybe you collect a couple of dollars so you could go and invest in the studio. But the first thing is to get a job. So something that dudes do all the time is they make an excuse. I'm a rapper. I want to rap. And they sitting on a couch playing 2K all the time. Baby mom working, that's not it. You gotta get a job. Get a couple of dollars. Now, live your dream. Music, get your beats, get your rhymes going, go in the studio, do your thing. Social media is free. So the best thing for you to do is use social media. It's free. And a lot of times, it's about not what you know, but who you know, right?
Right.
You got to network. When this shit is over, this corona thing, you got to go around, see wherever Big Boy's at, see wherever Felly Fell, wherever these guys is at, they got to know who you are.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay, okay.
That's the best advice I can give you.
Okay, okay, okay. I appreciate you, man.
And wear the mask, man. Wear the mask.
Yeah, boy. All right.
I can't lie to you. If you got a guy sleeping, women, if you have a man sleeping on your couch about to turn 40, talking about he raps, but we've never seen a record, a mixtape, a video, Tell them they're hiring construction, UPS, somewhere, get a job. That is a Joper moment. That is a Joper moment. Get a job. A real one. See, yeah, I mean, that's what you could do, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm gonna be honest with you.
Can you see me?
I can see you. How you doing? What's your name? Where you from?
I'm Bonnie Chambers. I'm from Southside of Chicago. I remember you a couple of years ago in 1996 with you and Big Pun.
Yeah, me and
you
Big
guys
Pun.
Was at the yes, you all was at the Chicago Regal Theater.
Yes, 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 yes.
Yeah. I remember you all, and I was like, man, when Big Pop died, I was like, my heart really went out to you guys because I knew how close you guys were.
Yeah, it was probably the darkest, one of the darkest moments of my life. You know what I'm saying? I went through depression. I had to go to psychiatrist. You know, there's a lot of pressure. You know, my best friend, my brother passed away.
Right.
And this is just this big pressure on you because you just like, and then you deal with the, what if we could have did, you know, we'd have worked out,
right.
We'd have lost weight, we would have did, you know, you start blaming yourself for everything. So, you know, and yeah, we did, that was a big L, bro. That was a big
L. Yeah, because my heart, and I was praying that you get well because I heard that you went to a deep depression. I'm like, oh, my God, no. Fat Joe got to hurry up. He got to recuperate from this. You know, we got to live.
It's hard when you wake up, the sunny day look cloudy. You know what I mean? Every day you wake up and you start fighting. See, the thing is in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
So it ain't like somebody shooting at you on the south side and you move to the north side.
Right.
That beef come with you wherever you go.
So, yes.
So when he passed away, I came down to Miami, but the first second I go in a restaurant, the waiter's like, yo, sorry about your brother. And all these things keep coming back. So it's a hard thing, you know, because I like to think for the most part, I'm a little smart of a guy. And it took me 2 years to figure that out and to get out of it. You know what I'm saying? And it was hard.
Yeah.
It's really, really, really hard. I remember nights I used to sleep in the tub, no water, just staring at the ceiling trying to figure it out. You know what I mean?
Right. But,
you know, what could you do, man? You know what I'm saying? What could you do?
Yeah.
But I thank you for the call. You being safe with this corona thing, right?
I got my cover. I got my cover, so
yeah. I'm covered. God bless you.
I got to because you know what? It's so much in Chicago because we are higher ranked with the coronavirus. So it's like when I had to go to work, I'm like first off. You know, first when I mean by first off, I do help from home. I work with home health care. So I have to be covered and I have to be safe because when my clients people come in to visit them. It's like, no, let me hurry, put my mask on, you know, let me put my gloves on, let me disinfect everything.
You know,
so it's like really hard.
It affects people different ways. I got friends that caught the corona and it was gone in a week. I got friends that caught the corona and they died. It is crazy. It's just, you don't know how it's going to affect you. That's the scariest part about it. All
right. Right.
Let me get to some other people. God bless you. Who's that?
God bless you too, Fat Joe. And this is my daughter.
Stop. She ain't playing with it.
Okay. Yes. All right, it is. Salute to you. Be strong. Bye.
All right. Man, that's the love right there. You know what I'm saying? That's a shout out to Chicago. One of my homes away from homes. You know, just like New York is a big city and everybody lives on top of each other for the most part. And so it's real difficult, man, when you're living in a building and 140 families living in there, everybody touching the buttons. You know what I'm saying? And it's not easy, you know what I'm saying? So shout out to Chi-Town. Chi-Town, coming out there, you know, when this Dies Down. Shout out to Pito. You know, we're working on that movie, you know? We're working on that movie based in Chicago. Let's see who this is. You know what I'm saying? You never been to New York where you realize this corona let you know life is short, man. So you need to get out. All right, my brother, what's your name? Where you from?
Joe, what's going on, man? Spider, New York City.
All right, my brother, what's going on? How you doing, man?
I'm all right. I lived in New York City all my life at Barrio, Spanish Harlem.
All right, East Side.
East Side. I've seen everything go down from... You know, I think the virus is bigger than what they're telling us. You know what I'm saying? I think not everybody's catching it, but I do believe it's something that happened. You know, they give us all this, you know, these flu shots and all these other shots that we got to take. I was on the front line. I never caught it. But I know people that took flu shots, that took this, and they caught it. You know what I'm saying? I know people that slept next to their wives and... You know, their wives never caught it, but they caught it. And I asked them, your wife ever came from, you know, your wife ever took a flu shot? No, she came from another country. She never took the shots from New York. She never took the mandatory shot from school. She never took the mandatory shots that we have to take.
Well, you know what? The thing is that the coronavirus is crazy because it don't discriminate, and actually, it does. If you want to get racial, this is a racial virus because the brown and black people are the people dying the most. And so because of underlying conditions, asthma, hypertension, diabetes, you know, because we already was effed up. You know what I'm saying? And then this thing is like, it's like, you know, when you go to a club and they got a line and everybody's online, but if you pay VIP, you get right in.
Yeah.
So, like, everybody's already fucked up with diabetes, asthma, high blood pressure, cholesterol. And then it's like everybody was on the long line. And now Corona come and be like, yo, VIP, baby. Like, let's go. It's over for you.
I mean, it affects
people different ways. It gives some people strokes, some people heart attacks. You know, it's a crazy thing. And you know, I want everybody to live their life. I know everybody want to go back to normal. I'm looking at all the restaurants. They ran packed. I'm looking at it. You know, my man Percy was filming a basketball game yesterday in the Projects High Bridge. It's about 2,000 people out there watching, no mask. Bro, I don't know what's going to happen. So if we believe that coronavirus is the most infectious virus, it kept us in the house for 3 months. And all of a sudden, the shit gone, and everybody hanging out, everybody protesting, everybody—I don't even know, man. I don't. I'm really scared to find out the new numbers of what's going on.
I think myself. I think they won't put the new numbers out there personally, because this is going to cause an epidemic, and they already did, especially in New York City, where it's the heart. Of the money, the heart of the money. This is where it came to, you know what I'm saying? This is where it came to. You mess with the, you fuck with the money, you fuck with the, you know, you the world, basically the world. And why was New York City the first place it came to and it hit everybody so hard? You know, because they say
that New York City is a place where everybody flies in. So supposedly, if we go and listen to what they're telling us, it came from Wuhan, China. It went to Europe. Europe messed up all Italy and Spain and all that. And those people were flying to the U.S. to where? New York. The money capital.
But you know what's crazy?
Where they got business at. And then us, we're like a cluster. So like in New York, there's so many people in New York City working with each other, living on top of each other. So the thing is just spreading. And that's how it became so big in New York.
I think they didn't take the precaution because I live in Florida now. I live in Florida. I moved out of New York because of this. I'm in Florida now. I live in Davenport. I just moved out here 2 weeks ago because of all this shit going on. You know, the schools. Who knows what's gonna happen when them schools open? You know, we don't know what's gonna happen to them kids. We don't know what's gonna happen. You know, we don't know what's going to happen to them teachers.
I'm doing the reverse. I've been living in Miami my whole life.
Yeah, I see that.
My family acting like they want to go back to New York now.
I don't think so.
When it's on and popping.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we do everything backwards, man.
Yeah, it's a fact.
We do backwards to call the genius, you know?
I mean, you know what's crazy is? I travel to a lot of countries and a lot of places. And not once when I travel, why didn't I get stopped? I came from all type of countries. Why didn't I get stopped and get, you know what I'm saying, put the little temperature on me and get me the little to check me to see if I got anything? They didn't do nothing. It was an easy pass in, easy pass out. Easy pass in, easy pass out to all those countries I went to. And I seen so many people go to so many countries, and it was easy in, easy out. Only place that didn't check me, but they ran my name and all that, was coming into Florida. You know, you got the TSA, you got the army people there. They make you sign the little waiver when you come in and all of that. But that's the only place that made me actually sign something.
All right, my brother, stay safe, my brother. God bless
you. You too, my brother. God bless you too. You already.
Yeah, God bless. So what's happening in Miami, right? I can tell you. You people don't like it. You don't like when I tell y'all the truth. What's happening in Miami is New York City is on a legal lockdown. Now, if you're in the street, you're in the street. So Miami's opened up. So anybody who got a dollar is running down to Miami because the restaurants is open. I live on the water, so I see the little boats. So anybody from New York who's seeing their people on the boat like this, I'm watching them. I live on the water. You know New York dudes when they got the long shorts and the Timbs on, tank top on, they won't take their shirt off on it. I'm looking at all this shit. And so they coming down. So my brother E. Rivera, he from New York, his birthday 2 days ago. He didn't do the party in New York. He came to Miami. 100 guys. My brother, happy birthday, Choppy Dali Chop. He got a party right now. My brother Nori, I love him to death. He's in a restaurant every night with a bunch of guys. This is what's happening in Miami right now. So the whole New York who couldn't come out for 3 months running down here at the fastest rate to get it popping. That's what's happening right now. So what this guy say? Because everybody's a philosopher or some shit. Most people died. They 50s, 60s, you know, when you're going to die. Now you don't know when you're going to die. Rachel Noy, messing you like crazy. Reverend Child for 40 minutes. Listen, Rachel, you know I love you. I'm going to text Reverend out, and then we'll set it up for another day where he's definitely in the right Wi-Fi. You know, I've been down with Reverend Al for many, many years since the march in the streets of New York with him for Abner Louima or Amadou Diallo or Anthony Baez. I love Reverend Al. Nobody can tell me nothing about Reverend Al, man. You know, I'm into people who's into defending others. I'm into people who are takes their life and makes it for others. And consistency. All right, you don't want to sit around, but when your ass gets some tubes in you, it's a thing. Let me tell you something. Shout out to my man Dominic from Low Cali, that best pizza in Miami. Hands down, New York ill pizza with the turkey pepperoni, the beef pepperoni. I know Rachel. I will call him, Rachel, I will. Reverend Al, he's good. Reverend Al, we love him. I know he ain't disrespect us. We love Reverend Al, man. He been too consistent, man. Shit. We know we'll make it happen. It's all good. And so, I love people who put themselves on the line for others and consistent. You know, it's all about being consistent. So this is what happened, right, guys? If you didn't know what happened, this is what happened. So we was on lockdown. Obviously, everybody got to make money. Nobody can live in their house forever. Well, some people can't. I can't. And so people have to open back up. You know, Trump is a guy. You voted for Donald Trump simply for money, not for his looks, not for anything else. You voted for Donald Trump because you wanted money and you thought he was a billionaire that could make dreams come true and money was going to float out the sky, whatever. He was going to save you taxes. He, you know, the man. Damn, man, I don't want to bash the man so bad on him, man, but the man did everything you could, like, you know, the man, he gave you every reason not to vote for him. But you said, we're going to make money. You voted for him. So now we stuck in the house, COVID. It's not his fault. First time in 100 years, it's a pandemic. The whole world's on lockdown. What he says, yo, we got to get money. The economy is messing up. We doing bad. We don't want to bankrupt the country. So everybody got to come out and work. From the moment they decided to open up, it meant, all right, everybody, press your luck. Whoever's going to make it is going to make it. Whoever's going to die is gonna die. That's it. That's what's been going on out here. What's been going on out here is, all right, they open back up. Go to work. Be very careful. Wear your mask and your gloves. Because if you die, it ain't on me. The man about to give a speech, a rally, the first one since Corona in Tulsa, Oklahoma. They handing out these things saying, yo, if you catch it and you die, it's not my fault. You came to the rally. And basically, that's what's going on. You know, that's what's going on. You wanted the man. Look, I add you, bro. I add you. You keep saying, Joe, add me. We not scared of no talk from nobody. I clicked you. What's your name, bud? Yo, what's up, my brother?
What's up, Joe? How are you?
I'm okay, man. What's your name? Where you from?
My name is Diaz. I'm originally from Kazakhstan. I don't know if you heard about Kazakhstan.
I've heard of Kazakhstan. Yes, I have.
Yes, but I live in New York. I live in Astoria now, in Queens.
All right. What's going on, my brother?
Bro, first time I met you, it was at Ralph McDaniel's 35th year music video box at Coney Island.
Wow. Oh, yeah. That was amazing. I came out with KRS-One, my mentor.
Yeah, that was a great performance, bro.
Yeah. That was beautiful out in Brooklyn.
Yes. So we connected to Ralph through our foundation.
Ralph McDaniels is one of my mentors. He's one of the people who helped me get in the music business and gave me a big shot. I love Ralph McDaniels, his whole family.
He is great. We connected to Ralph through our foundation. But man, listen, right. I just want to share my story. I did have a coronavirus back in January when I was actually in Kazakhstan. And at that time, nobody knew what was going on. Everyone thought that.
I believe the same. I caught corona before. Nobody knew what corona was.
Everybody thought it was like a regular virus.
Felt like right. A truck hit me.
Nobody could understand what's going on. Everybody was just sick at home, you know, for 3-4 days. Nothing was happening. Like, people were treating it as a regular, you know, regular virus. And it was just so hard to overcome. But, you know, and then I finally got my antibodies test a couple of days ago. And, you know, it showed that I got antibodies. Right.
Yeah, right. That's what I want to do, man. I don't know why I haven't done one yet. We got to do that antibody test to know if we had it or not. Very important.
Yeah, now they do it all together, you know, two tests.
Oh, they do it both to see if you got it. Thank God I don't think I got it. You know what I mean? So, but we're doing both, man. But listen, my brother, stay safe, man. Do your thing. And you already know, all right?
Okay, I appreciate you, bro. Take care.
Kazakhstan, of course I know about Kazakhstan. One time I performed for the president's daughter of Kazakhstan. One time. Yeah, it wasn't in Chicago. I was good at Chicago. What happened was, it was in, Super Bowl was in Miami. We had a big party celebration for J-Lo during the halftime. And we was in there with a bunch of people. And the next day when I came home, shit was crazy. For 2 weeks I was on the couch. Shit was knocking me out. Shout out Wynwood Tattoo. What's up, baby? I try to get you, Lance. I just try to get you, Mr. Lance. Four more years, Donald Trump. Oh, good for you. You want to feel like this? Yeah, y'all niggas is crazy, bro, out here, bro. All right, Juanita, what you said? Yo, Joe, what's the one thing you learned about yourself during quarantine? What I learned was that life is very fragile and you're really not promised tomorrow. And although everybody says two things that are guaranteed is death and taxes, we don't never really think about death. And we don't want to think about death. But when you in here and you seeing so many, yo, it was a time, y'all know, y'all was watching on the Fat Joe show where I was announcing 3-4 different people a day that was dying. This shit was every day for like 2 months straight. You know, we lost Fred the Godson, Andre Orell. That's just, you know, we lost my man Flex's mom's Marina. We lost JB's father. We lost with Eric from Nike. We lost wild people every day. Right? And so it just let me know how fragile life was, where I was like, holy shit. We could die. You know? So in quarantine, I realized how fragile life is. And I'm not telling you I'm not scared to die. But what I have realized and come to the realization is we're going to die, like from something, from one thing or another. And just, you know, like, wow, you know, Fred the Godson, that's my brother, man. You know, just tough. It was a tough time. And it's time for it's a rough time for everybody. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, China don't tell us. Let me tell you something. These people have telescopes that can show you how many pimples you got on your face. You watch the movies. The movies is there for a reason. Let me tell you. See, I need a guest because I don't really want to go into that Fat Joe mode because you guys ain't ready. You talking that shit, but you're not really ready. So what happens is, I feel like if you see these movies where they can send drones to just blow up Bin Laden in the middle of the desert, 17 hours away, you're gonna tell me that the telescope or whatever is just up there can't see that people are sick in China? You can't see that the people are sick in China? You know the people are sick. Anybody walking around with masks, this, that. You're supposed to been closed down the border. Like, to me, you would look at me even worse than Trump. I'd have closed the shit down. I'd have brought the National Guards. Now, where everybody was acting stupid on the corners, Bronx, Harlem, man, I'd have brought an army up in and smack them upstairs to their house. Different. I would have did it different. and shut everything down. Pull you by your underwear up the stairs, your ass going in. And that would have been that. And by now, everything would have been down. But now, as much as we stay home and we say, we would have stood at home. I still home for 3 months. I'm still home. But the cases is going up. So it's a scary thing, you know, and a lot of people have arguments with vaccines. A lot of people. So Trump, yes, he did not do the right thing. He did not. He should have shut down the borders long before. A lot of people died in the hospitals that didn't have to die. We didn't have enough equipment. I mean, at one point they were saying, like, they was like, you know, the bodies were just in body bags. Like, you know, they didn't really get the right attention they deserved. You know, and yet and still you guys are like, yo, Trump 2020, Trump's the only one helping the black community. I like to know how, man. All my people is broke. Wait, let me get them on here. Let me get this good old supporter on here. Let me see. Let's go.
Yeah. What's good?
Show your face, my brother. You gotta show your face.
I am OG. I'm trying to see how you flip this damn camera. What up, OG?
I can't see you that good, but God bless, man. I see you.
I'm black. I'm super black. Right, I'm super black.
It's okay. We got Akon on here. You can't be blacker than Akon. Well, check this out, man. What's your name? Where you from?
My name JB. I'm from Camden, New Jersey.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. Oh,
Camden. You know, everybody, yeah. Is it really the truth that the police have changed in Camden?
Yeah. Yeah, they
all over, like the whole country studying the Camden, New Jersey Police Department, saying that's the way we got to move now.
It's a movement, man. It's a real movement. And what we really need to, like, know seriously, like, as black people and as the black community, it's really great to have a movement, to have a Black Lives Matter, or to say I can't breathe, you know, or whatever movements we want to have. It's great to have that, but it's not great to have it if it's going to be led by the same people that's actually creating things. You feel me? Like, real rap, like, the same people that's creating things are the same people that's running the Black Lives Matter movement. Like, when these young kids are stepping up and they're starting and they're representing and coming out there and throwing their bodies out there to sacrifice themselves just to speak in front of police officers, they're not looking to be attacked or anything like that, but it's a strategy and a setup for us to be out there and get attacked.
Okay, so you saying the Black Lives Matter, the people who do the Black Lives Matter are actually behind all it? I don't get what you're saying, my brother.
Okay, well, what I am saying is they're telling us that the Democratic Party is for us. Like, I would love to represent the Democratic Party. I really would. As a black man, I would love to represent the Democratic Party
represent the Republican Party when...
Because... Now, let me explain the reason why I represent, and I would say I would represent Trump, because everything that Trump had done for us, it on paper is better than what the Democratic Party has actually done for us and the bills that has gotten passed. Honestly, the reason why that the borders were shut down was because Trump shut them down. Do you understand that the government?
2 months late. 2 months late, bro.
Wait, let me explain. Hold on. You're right. Now let me explain why. Because, listen, the governors in each state, Trump can't just run into the state and say, yo, I'm bringing martial law to do XYZ. The governors have to say, yo, Trump, bring them in. The governors was letting anarchy happen in front of our faces, bro. Like, they was allowing it to...
You talking about two different things, right? So...
Uh-huh.
So... They didn't. They stopped the flights coming in. Trump could have did that 2 months ahead, bro. Trump.
He wanted to.
Okay. Trump was.
He wanted to.
Trump was worried about the stock market. And so he was trying to play down the coronavirus. And he was worried about that money. And then he didn't want to tell him. So when his own elected official, I forget what the lady was, said, yo, this is real. That's when he finally said, yo, we got to take it. We got to let people know it's real. And we got to chill. But he was worried about that stock market. And that money.
Okay. And I can.
When you voted for Trump, you voted him.
Listen. I haven't voted yet. I'm still watching. My thing is this. This is what I'm trying to express, OG. I'm only trying to express one thing. I haven't voted yet. I would.
Man, regardless, we're Democrats, I would, Republicans, Independents. We all American. I love you. That's not the question. The question is, I'm trying to understand and answer you what I feel about the situation. You say whatever you want to. That's why I picked you.
And look, that's why I'm glad you did give me an opportunity to speak. If I felt as though the Democratic Party was representing us properly and was for us in any possible way, I would totally be for the Democratic Party. But if you do your research into the Democratic Party and where the Republican Party came from, the Republican Party was started from black men. Black men started the Republican Party. It was us. We ran it. We owned it. We blessed it. We grew well in the Republican Party starting that. We started that. Now, I'm not going to waste all the time and go deep into where, you know, why it was fucked up and how they took things from us.
I want to know why Donald Trump put Mexican kids in cages. I want to know why Donald Trump co-signs the white supremacists every chance he gets. And when the whole country... Listen, bro.
Go ahead.
President's job is to calm everything down for everybody. If you're a Republican, George Bush was a Republican. If something was happening, he was still saying, y'all, I'm the president for the Democrats. Whether he didn't agree with the Democrats. Why Donald Trump can't seem to embrace the fact that George Floyd was murdered on videotape and can't say nothing about the police department. And he goes out there and talks about the law and the order cop.
I'm with that 100%. No black man or any man should be murdered, period. And Trump needs to, like you said, come up and speak about that specifically. Well, now, listen, hold on. Wait one second. He needs to speak about that specifically so that could be spoken to just like you said, so we can all get an answer for that particular thing. Now, I have not heard Trump say one thing about the black community and how we are bad. I heard him say that there are terrorists. I heard him say that there are terrorists that are fucking up our community. Brother, do you know who the terrorists are?
My brother.
It's not me and you, Joe.
My brother, in Charlottesville. It was a protest of white supremacists. They killed a young lady. Trump called them nice people. Great guys.
Who? The killers? No. You got to listen to the whole interview.
Brother,
did you hear the whole interview or a clip?
I listened to the whole thing. He said, there's some good people, there's some bad people, but I seen good. Bro.
You guess what? Don't listen to the whole clip and then just take it. Because when he say good people, he's talking about you and me.
Me and you.
He's not talking.
No, me and you. But the problem is we're going to make people really know that Fat Joe knows what he's talking about. And I like to play dumb and be a gangster rapper. So I don't want to tell you. I listen to the full interviews, the longest versions you can look at.
That's what's up.
You understand what I'm saying?
That's what's up.
This man, when he came on the scene, he said he's talking for the silent majority. The silent majority means he thinks, and he was right, in the middle of the country, these white people believe just like he believes. They just ain't telling us. So they went
and look, you're right, but the only reason why I would agree with Trump, the only reason I agree with Trump, because I know the people he's going against, which is the deep state, are really trying to vaccine us. They're really listen, bro. They really want to hold us in a crib. They got a strategy set, and Trump is telling us. He's literally telling us to think whether he's with them or not. He might even be with them. All I'm saying is the brother is literally telling us the people that we're fighting against. The Democratic Party are out to get us, bro. And it's sad that people falling for the actual stuff that, because look, if they wasn't, the bread would come back to us, little people like me.
The Democratic Party, I can't confirm that the Republicans were started by black people. I don't know that much.
I did the research, Joe.
I'm going to look it up now. There's some form.
Thank you, my brother.
Along the line, it's changed.
And you know why?
Because
why they think Trump is KKK, because the KKK is the reason why it has changed. And this is why we think that Trump represents KKK.
So you say the KKK is the Democrats?
Absolutely, 100%. No, beloved, listen. Look, I would never, look, if I didn't...
I can't do it with
no,
you.
No, it's not all. It's not all. That's like me saying cops is bad. It's not all, bro. It's not all. It's not all. That's like saying that one, you know, that's like the cop that put his knee on the neck. We like, that nigga fucking killed George. So we mad, and it seemed like we mad at all cops. We not mad at all cops, but we saying, look, y'all still got to pay attention to, huh?
We are mad at a lot of them.
You're right. But what we're saying is, look, the ones that ain't like that, y'all need to pay attention to the ones that.
Some of you that I know, it's not something I'm thinking. Please listen to me if you respect Fat Joe.
I do, OG.
They had to pass a law in America. A law, like, you know, went up for votes. You know, a law. They had to pass a new law. The law was based on a police officer. Prior to this law, before George Floyd, if a cop was killing somebody, you and his partner, you know they too deep, you couldn't even tell him, yo, chill, stop killing them. They had to pass a law for another cop, a partner, to tell his partner now, as of George Floyd, yo, my man, chill. Killing him.
Right.
Law pass.
Right.
You know how crazy it is out here?
Cops,
let me tell you something. Cops are getting away. Look, I was ready for rapping out, right? Let me tell you one story. There's a story in the Bronx. I'm not in the Bronx, New York, back in the day. It's called Anthony Rosario and Hilton Vega. These guys had handcuffs to their back. Handcuffs, and got shot in their back 22 times by the cops. And the cops got away and didn't do no time for that. Beat the charges, beat everything. You tell me how you got handcuffs and get shot in your back, execution style, and you never go to jail. In Minnesota, so many people got murdered by cops. A cop never went to jail. Do you know who was the one cop who went to jail? He was a black Muslim from Somali that was a cop, and he killed the white woman. This is why he's the only one in the world to ever go to jail. Like, I don't know what you're seeing or what you think.
What I'm seeing, OG, the only thing I'm seeing is that I know that those cops you're speaking about that shot him and beat every other black man and got away with it, is they're in the KKK clique. It's not all cops. It's only some of them. Like the murder of George Floyd, that 8-minute murder was a long murder, beloved. And he did that with a straight face. You heard? So I can imagine if he was with a terror face, like, raw. You know, that man did that with a straight face. You dig me? So if he could do that with a straight face, I know he was sent to this is big, beloved. This is huge.
I would like to know, my brother, right? What do you consider yourself? What ethnicity?
I'm a black man. I'm a melanated being.
You're a black man. Are you an African?
A super melanated being.
Let me ask you a question. How come when Barack Obama was running for president, your man Trump was out there telling the white people that Obama is not a U.S. citizen, that he's not from the country? I want to know, how do you as a black man think that that is justified, that the man is saying Obama ain't black, he ain't from the U.S.? I want to know how you justify that, bro.
The only way I can justify it is when you go and do your history and you check up on who made who.
Wait. No.
Listen, this wait. When you go do your history and you check up on who made the Republican Party, you're gonna know that Trump did more for the black community than Obama. Facts, my nigga. This is listen. I do research.
I'm gonna say one thing, my brother, right? And I'm gonna give you
your would love for Obama to be it, dog. Listen, I'm black, listen. I'm melanated.
Listen, it's okay, whatever you saying, but listen, Trump passed a law. Obama passed
the law. I ain't saying he's super clean.
Listen, brother, let me just say, right? Obama passed the law that was the biggest law that no one could ever pass in history. Him and Joe Biden. And that was for everybody who had pre-existing conditions. They could get health care. Now, in the community, all these people that are dying right now with COVID, black and brown people, because they have diabetes, asthma, or hypertension, in the past, they could never get insurance. So that means if you got sick, you would die because they would not give you insurance. Barack Obama passed a law that no one was able to pass to help people get health insurance. That's bigger than any law that Trump passed. I'm gonna give you one good one that Trump passed, and that's the First Step Act, where people who had that was in jail, Van Jones worked with him on this, Hakeem Jeffries, these are Democrats. They worked on this on this law for people who had nonviolent charges, and they was in jail way past more than they were supposed to. So they brought them out. I'm gonna give you that one thing, and I think Trump did that for now. So me and you could talk about that. Other than that, he don't give a fuck about black people.
Listen, I gotta go. I love you too. Hey, listen, much respect.
Number love.
Peace.
There you have it. And so a lot of people voted for Trump, Lucky Church. A lot of people voted for Trump. A lot of poor white people in working in the coal mines. Trump said he was going to bring the coal back. Never brought it back. And all these people, they, you know, this guy had a show on TV that was marketing and promoting him as one of the smartest businessmen of all time. It was called You Fired. And so these people believed in him because they saw him on TV every day. And I don't think they're happy with him. I don't think they're really, really happy with him. And hey, man, everybody, look, you Republican, I got some friends that are Republicans and I love them to death. They're my family. They don't want to talk politics with me because they know how strong I am about politics. You know, I don't know how you, I mean, I see it two different ways, and that's the problem with the whole country. We see it two different ways. You got one half that sees it as a Trump supporter, who feels like they're making America great again. And then you got the other side that says, I cannot believe my eyes and what's going on here. So when you have Trump, the reason why the avenue in front of the White House is called Black Lives Matter Boulevard now is because the army came in and shot rubber bullets to people's heads, nonviolent protesters, and we got rights for that. It's in the Constitution. You can protest nonviolently. shot him up, beat him up, threw him all out of there, this, that, to show people that he's the big cheese. And he went out there and just pulled out a Bible in front of the, man, come on, man. You know, I mean, it's time to wake up, man. It's time to really, really wake up. And I know people say, yo, Joe, you wake up, because they got the, you know, they think of the 5G, Wi-Fi, the vaccine. You know, we got some deep thinkers, you know. And I ain't going to argue with each one of you guys, but, you know, that guy, he kept saying, add me in, Trump. Yo, Trump, Trump. And I was like, all right, let's get to talking. But I hope I woke him up somehow, or, you know, sometime, somehow, you know, at least made him think about it, man. But, yo, listen, put God first. Reverend Al Sharpton, somebody who I look up to, somebody who's for the people. His Wi-Fi wasn't working. We'll get him right. Yeah, homeboy's cousin works for the Pentagon. Yeah, you remember when COVID started? Everybody's cousin worked in the Pentagon? Get the fuck out of here. Yo, everybody, yo, my man works in the Pentagon. Like, Pentagon. I never met a motherfucker in my life working in the Pentagon. Yo, my cousin's in the, yeah, all right. And so that's what it is for me. You know what I'm saying? We can have different political beliefs, but I still love you if you respect me, and I respect you. We're all American, and that's the biggest fact, is that we're all American, whether who we love as president or who we don't, and we can be passionate about it. But, you know, when a president becomes president, they're supposed to be for everybody, the president of everybody. And this president has definitely been one-sided. And I don't know how else to explain it to you. That's where we at now. I'm definitely voting for Joe Biden. 1,000,000%. Even if Corona's around here, you'll see me in the middle of the streets bigging up Joe Biden, because we just got to get this man out of here. That's just my opinion. I guess we got our taste of the action. So when Obama became president, so you got to imagine, right? So, damn, man, I might be going too real with you. So you got to imagine. They call this the land of the free, home of the brave, equal rights. It was amazing to see after 400 years of slavery, plus Jim Crow, civil rights, everything that went on, to see a black man become president. I remember going to the club that night and seeing my president is black, right? And so when we were happy, there was somebody else who felt like dying, which was called the white supremacists. They wanted to die while we were partying, and then we did it to them twice. And so out of all that urge of like anger of, we can't take it no more, let's vote Trump, right? So they vote Trump. And that's the day we felt like we was dying, and we felt like, yo, the world was over, because I know I felt like that. And me as an American, I act like I don't know politics, but I know a lot about politics. And it's incredible because I've seen so much shit I've never seen happen before while this guy is here. And as far as at the border, calling Mexican rapists and drug dealers, as far as Charlottesville, calling them nice, just a million things. You know, the man has not addressed George Floyd yet. It's 21 days of protests all over America, all over the world. The man still hasn't addressed George Floyd the right way. And That's a problem to me, man. That's a problem to me. And I'm not going to go as far as saying everybody in the world's laughing at us, because they really was laughing at us all around the world. You know, if y'all don't know and y'all don't leave y'all hood, I go all around the world. So, you know, I get in Australia and get in the car with the driver. He's laughing. He can't believe we voted Trump. And I go to Dubai, they can't believe it. And everywhere I went, they can't believe it. But here we got my brother from Camden talking about he gonna go for the man. You don't know, man. What I do know is that there's a reason why Jerry Springer had a show for fucking 30 years. There's some crazy motherfuckers in America, man. Yo, God bless. Put God first. Trust in God. I see you tomorrow. My guest, one of my guests is Carl Hasty. Carl Hasty is the speaker, the black speaker, Democrat, who signed a law that if a police officer chokes you out in New York City, he will get 15 years in jail. Shout out to my brother, Carl Hasty. He come tomorrow. I'm also going to have a rapper come on after that. I'm going to confirm him tonight. Reverend Al, sure, he'll be back and he'll entertain us and talk that talk. I really wanted that talk. Rachel Noyd, I know you worked hard. The Action Network, I know you worked hard, but we'll get him on here. Peace. The Big Show.